Before we get started, I'd like to say for the holiday season, both Jeff and I will be taking a break from the show. We'll be back in the future with more episodes, so RCE will still be here.
Yeah, so just wanted to make sure that if you're watching the website or the RSS feed, you'll see a gap of a couple of weeks before you see us start up again in January. It's kind of an unwritten rule. You're not supposed to put time-related notices within the podcast, but we just want to make sure that you're all aware that we'll be gone for a couple weeks, but then we'll be back after the holiday season.
Welcome to another edition of RCE. I'm your host, Brock Palin. And again, I have from OpenMPI and Cisco Systems, Jeff Squyres. Jeff, thanks for joining us from your offices halfway across the country.
Good morning, Brock. How's it going?
Not bad. Today we've had a guest that we've been trying to get on the show for a little while, and luckily we've found some time to get them on. We have David Vanderspool from Gromacs. I believe it's an MD package. I have a number of users that use Gromacs, and it's pretty familiar, and I believe it's involved with some other projects out there. He's at the University of Uppsala in Sweden, so we're actually 6 hours time zone different here, so thanks, David, for helping us out at such a different time.
Yeah, and I want to give the standard disclaimer here up at the front, a little known secret. We do a little coordination before we start recording these things, and we have definitely determined that we cannot pronounce David's name properly, and we cannot pronounce his university properly or his town properly because we're ugly Americans. So we give all the standard disclaimers and apologize for all of that in advance.
Okay. Well, I appreciate that you guys are trying anyway. So,
well, why don't you introduce yourself and tell us your involvement with Gromacs?
Yeah, so I'm a professor of computational molecular biophysics in the biology department in the University of Uppsala, and have been working on Gromacs for close to 20 years now.
So let's roll right in. I'm sure not everybody listening knows what Gromacs is or uses a similar. There's a number of MD packages out there. Is Gromacs an MD package, or am I completely off base here?
No, you're absolutely right. It's a molecular dynamics simulation package, and the abbreviation, it stands for Groningen Machine for Chemical Simulation, which is a quite ugly name, but Gromacs is easy to recall, I would think.
What was a little bit of the history behind Gromacs? Like, where did it come from? What was its intended purpose from inception?
So in the late 80s, people started experimenting with parallel computing, and since molecular dynamics is a well-known resource hog, parallel computing was an obvious thing to do. And basically, we started from scratch, writing a code in C based on older MD codes that were around with the functionality that we knew. And we started doing stuff in parallel on transputers, and then moved on to more common things like workstation clusters from there.
Transputers?
So this is a special kind of chip made by an English company called InMOS, who built a chip that had built-in communication hardware 15 years before the Opteron. It was very ingenious, but alas, computing and programming was a bit cumbersome, so it was hard to use in effect.
So I have to ask, if you were using transputers back in the early 90s and late 80s, did you happen to use LAM, perchance?
I don't think we used LAM. No, we had the things in the box hooked up to a Sun computer, and we were programming an OCaM, and OCaM was hell because of the weird rules for writing the code, that you have fixed indentation. And just when I thought I got over that bit with fixed indentation coding, then Python came on, and I thought, well, bad things never go away.
Oh, wow. Yeah, the reason I ask is because it's a little-known fact. Today's the day for secrets and little-known facts, apparently, that LAM MPI, its very first target was transputers back in the early 90s. And it was actually a publicity stunt to add the MPI layer, which eventually became the dominant and most used part of it. But I just haven't heard the word transputers in many years. So small, small world.
Well, that's the history.
Yes, excellent. Well, so who uses Gromacs and why do they use it? So you talked a little bit about the history and, you know, that parallelism was an obvious target. Could you give us some examples, too, about, you know, why you needed to spread onto multiple machines and how did that spread throughout the community?
So who uses Gromacs? Let's start there. I think in chemistry and biology is our main target. We also have quite a few physicists out there. And people use it for anything that you can use the kind of classical model for. So anything from biomolecules to carbon nanotubes to gases. I guess there are about 5,000 to 10,000 academic users, quite a few industrial users as well.
Cool.
Yeah, so we have a mailing list with 2,000 people on there, so and they're willing to send out with 40 emails per day, so it's quite a spam there. But there's probably more users than these that are subscribed to the mailing list.
Yeah, so, we always find it's very hard to tell, you know, particularly in open source, you know, how many users do you have? You have no idea because, you know, the silent majority of people who just download and use, you have no idea. But it's nice to hear that you have so many subscribers and so much of an active mailing list community. That's a very good indicator. So I'm sorry, I did ask you a barrage of questions there. Let me go through a different one of those again because I asked you all at once. When you started Gromacs, back in the history part there, how did you do the parallelism itself? You mentioned some of the models that you used and whatnot, but back in the early 90s and whatnot was before even MPI was standardized. PVM was just starting to come out, and there were, you know, dozens of different parallel models before kind of the community settled on one. So how did you guys develop this? You know, what models did you end up using and why?
Yes, well, apart from Occam, we tried a few things. So this was basically before PVM even. We had a homebrew compiler that did parallel Pascal and was made at the computer science department in our university in Groningen in the Netherlands. We played with that as well, but we found it wasn't stable enough. So the first try was to go for C with a commercial library for parallelism. And I think we used that for a little while. And then we moved on to PVM and later on MPI. If it's of interest, we actually also built a machine with another kind of hardware, Intel i860s, that used to end up in printers and stuff because they were good for that stuff, with a special hardware communication, which was also made for us by a company. And we had a big rack filled with 32 of these boxes, 32 processors, each of them 5 megaflops or so. So this was really breakthrough performance at the day.
So you guys really used a lot of specialty hardware. You were really kind of digging to find every little bit you could of performance that was out there at the available technology at the time.
Yes, initially it was even worse or even more ambitious, I should say, in that we were planning to make our own, implement the algorithms in hardware, basically. But we soon found out that this basically was beyond our capabilities, and this is when we moved on to a programmable chip with special purpose communication, but at least a programmable chip for the main part of the code.
And that was the transputer? I'm not familiar with them, so...
No, this was the i860 from Intel.
Oh, okay.
So this was quite a bit faster than the transputer, actually.
So when you say programmable, you mean software programmable, not like hardware programmable, like an FPGA or something?
Exactly. This was just a normal processor. So this was basically Intel's first try at a fast processor, a RISC-like processor, like they did later with the Itanium. But they basically gave up on it.
Okay, so moving into how you derive modern performance, when I was building Gromacs, and I've built several versions of it for several users with different options on and off, where are you deriving most of your performance? I noticed there was a lot of assembly in there. It's pretty much is a lot of Gromacs in assembly, or?
Well, this is fun that you should ask this, because... from version 3.0, which was released in 2001, We had lots and lots of assemblies.